series. Today, we're gonna talk about how to train neural networks, why neural networks are good. We're gonna talk about deep learning, and then you know, the definition of deep learning, why we have been talking about neural nets and then talking about deep learning. That I'm gonna talk about in this section. And then after this, I'm gonna talk about special types of neural networks for particular applications. Okay. Before we begin, I wanna revisit the topics of yesterday's session. So we talk about the concept of a linear classifier, and then we talk about the concept of nonlinear classification, and then we derive something called a neural net, okay? And then we talk about the backpropagation algorithm to compute the gradient of the parameters in the neural net, given an example, right? So before we begin, we also want to let's visit the stochastic gradient descent algorithm. So I think this is a very important algorithm to remember. Okay. So the input to the algorithm, input is the pair of xi, yi. Okay. And then x, you know, x1 to xn, yn, where x is a vector in Rd maybe, right? And y is a scalar, it's in R, okay? Okay. And then we have to pick an architecture. Of choice. So this is using your experience, okay? So basically how many layers you want and how many neurons on each layer. And then we also have to pick an a learning rate, alpha, that's also experience. I'm going to talk about how to do this more clever, but so far just, you know, pick the architecture of your choice and pick a learning rate of your choice, okay? Now, then what we're going to do, we're going to have a loop. So we got for iteration equal to 1 to t. T is the number of iterations that you want to run your stochastic gradient descent. And then for any iteration, pick an example k, okay, maybe random. Pick an example somewhere in here at random, okay? And then forward prop. So take the example, multiply with a sequence of matrices, and apply nonlinearity to arrive at, to compute h, the decision function, right, of hk, theta, and b, right? And then also compute jk being the difference between h, theta, b, and your label, okay? So you're gonna look at the difference between your prediction, the decision function, and your label, okay? So that's what forward prop. Now, and then, in the same iteration, you do say back prop to compute the derivative of JK with respect to your parameter, okay? And then the JK with respect to your bias, okay? And then update. Theta, this is a vector, okay? Equal to theta minus alpha times DJK, d theta. This is also a vector, okay? And then B, also a vector, B vector minus alpha DJK, d B. Okay? So, this is the stochastic gradient descent. It's a very famous algorithm in training neural networks. What you do, you have a input data set, okay? A pair of example and labels. Then you have to pick your architecture. And then you do on it, you iterate through your data set many, many times. It may be T iterations. Then you, at every iteration, you pick a random example. Okay. And then you forward prop to compute the decision function, and then look at the difference between your decision function and label, and then back prop to compute the derivatives, right? And then make the update. And then when do you decide to converge? Okay. Converge maybe when theta and B don't change too much, okay? Or maybe after T. Okay? So after you run it T iteration, you've done, or maybe when theta and B don't change a lot. Okay? Okay. So there are 2 points of confusion in yesterday's session. Okay? Confusion number one is the idea of data partitioning. So I motivated neural network using the idea that you can actually take your data and divide it and then train to hypotheses, and then combine the hypotheses by training another neural network on top of it. But in reality, if you know the backpropagation algorithm already, you don't need to do data partitioning. The neural network will train end to end, so that you don't have to do data partitioning. So a lot of people came to me and say, how would I partition the data? The answer is that you don't have to, okay? If you know the backpropagation algorithm already, then you don't have to do it, okay? So the answer is no, you don't have to. So the second point of confusion was in yesterday's lecture when I take the derivative of Ji with respect to theta 1, for the linear classifier, this is basically equal to d theta 1 of h of x I theta b minus y I square. I made a mistake in the derivation. It should have been 2 times x I theta b minus y I, and then multiply by d of h divided by d of theta 1 h I theta b. And then you can plug in the equation for h, which is, you know, g, in fact, is 1 over 1 plus epsilon of minus theta x plus b. And then keep going with the derivation to arrive at the derivative, okay? So yesterday I made a mistake in this derivation, and I'm very thankful for many people who came up and told me that I made a mistake. Okay, so let's talk about how to train neural networks. Okay. So this issue brings me to the question that maybe in my you know, when I drive my gradient computation, I can make a mistake. You know, maybe I'm not good at math, right? I can make a mistake. So the question is, can you some way figure out how your gradient computation is incorrect or not? Okay? So the first question is how to debug backpropagation. Okay. So let's think about in 1D. Okay. Let's suppose you have a function f of x equal to x squared. Okay. So let's suppose that I have a method I write in C code somewhere that I compute the derivative of this function, right? And then I made a mistake. I don't know, 5x squared or something like that, somewhere in the code, okay? So is there any other way to actually write the derivative that you can check that your analytical derivative is incorrect? Okay? Anybody in here knows the answer? Yeah, that's correct. So so the answer is that you have to actually come back to the way how you define a gradient, right? The way that you define a gradient for a general function is basically the limit when epsilon goes to a very small number of f of x plus epsilon minus f of x. And then divided by epsilon. Okay. So, so let's suppose that we want to still compute the derivative of this function using this formulation. Okay. Then what you end up is basically limit of f of x, maybe x plus some epsilon. So let's pick epsilon to be maybe triple minus x triple divided by epsilon. Okay. Now let's say we want to take the derivative and evaluate that x equal to 0, 0, 1. Maybe x equal to 2, and then pick epsilon equal to 0, 0, 1. Okay. It's a very small number. I'm gonna pick epsilon to be a very small number, and when I evaluate this function again, okay, which is 2 plus 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, maybe you do computation and you work it out. It's basically 16. Okay. Now you want to. Now your gradient is correct, right? Let's say you write your code and you get this answer. Okay, you get that answer. Then you want to check whether your answer. This is numerical. Right, this method is numerical, this is analytical. Right. Then you evaluate that x equal to 0 at 2. At 2 is 3 times 2 squared, which is 12. Right. So now you can see that your numerical gradient and your analytical gradient seem to match up quite closely, right? 16.06 and 12.06 and 12. Right. So there's a way to check your gradient by basically using the numerical definition. You take some x and some epsilon, very small number, and then compute this value here explicitly, and then compare that with the analytical answer. Right? Is this clear? Okay. So basically, when I write my MATLAB code or C++ code or something like that, I wrote two functions, right? Function number one is to do backpropagation to compute the derivative this way, okay? That's the analytical way. And then, because I also can compute my function very well, I can also pick an epsilon and then vary the epsilon so that you can compute the numerical derivative as well. And then I have to check that the numerical derivative and the analytical derivative match up. Okay? So far I've been presenting the way to check the derivative of a function of one D, right? It's one dimensional. Can I do it with 2D? Or maybe ND, right? So let's suppose that J is a function of a vector theta, okay? Maybe I write it explicitly as J theta 1, theta 2, theta n. Let's say that. Let's say J is the n-dimensional function. Then to compute the derivative, one way is using backpropagation, right? Backprop will get you dj d theta I somewhere, right? But you also can compute numerically, right? You can find J of theta 1, theta 2, theta I plus epsilon. Then take that and divide it by epsilon. Okay? So you use your function evaluation to actually compute the derivative, and you want these two to match up. Okay? You want these two values to be very similar. Right? And the reason why this is a good way to do to check the gradient is because it's very simple. It only uses a function evaluation. Where this one, you really need to write the code, you know, the backprop code to compute the derivative. Is everything clear? Okay. So this is when I train neural networks. The first thing that I always do is to try to come up with a function that can debug my backpropagation. And I usually call it, you know, the unit test of backpropagation. So this is a unit test. Right? You keep checking your gradient until it's actually correct. Okay. So number two is break symmetry. So So far in this algorithm here, right, I say pick an architecture of choice, but I haven't told you how to initialize my parameters, okay? My theta or my b, right? It turns out that the way that people use it, you could say you pick theta to be zeros, you could pick b to be all zeros as well, but that usually doesn't work very well because all the neurons in the networks behave the same way. So the way that people fix it is pick theta to be random, and maybe b to also random as well. But sometimes people pick it to be just zeros. Okay. The second idea in initialization is avoid saturation. So what do I mean by that? So let's go back to the activation function that we have. So the activation function that we have look like this, right? So it's all zeros, and then so this is 0.5, right? If you initialize theta random but with very, very big magnitude, then a lot of your output in the neuron will end up with values over here. Okay? So then it will take a while for because here the gradient is very small. It will take a while to actually train the neural network to move back to here. Okay? And then conversely, let's say if you initialize your weight to be really, really small, then a lot of the values of your neurons will end up being here. Okay? And then it will take a while to move to train the neural network because the gradient here is very small. What I mean by the gradient is that when you take the back propagation, somewhere you have to multiply with your error coming down with the derivative of this function, which look like this. Right? So if you are in this area, right, then mostly your gradient is zero. And you don't want that. You want to initialize the weights in such a way that most of your neurons will end up in values between here and here. So maybe, minus 0.2 or, plus 0.2 or something like that. Okay? That's the third idea. That's the fourth idea. Monitor progress of your training. Right. On training and hold out set. Okay? So let's suppose that you have 100 examples. Your n is 100 examples. You can split at random 80% of them for training and 20% as a holdout set. And then you compute, you after several iterations, you're trying to compute, this is t, time, right? You're trying to compute the value of your j, the value of j during training. For training, this is the objective function that you're trying to minimize, and j for the holdout set. Okay? And then hopefully, if your training goes well, your j will descend. Okay? Right. So that's a good j to have. And then your holdout set is also, you know, maybe somewhere there, like that. This is good, right? Okay. Which is not good is maybe not good would be your j behaves something like that. Right? That means you pick very small learning rate or very large learning rate. Right? Your j fluctuates. Okay. So then you have to play around with your learning rate until you get something like that, look like that, right? Your objective function slowly decreases. Maybe it fluctuates somewhere there, right? But should be small. Shouldn't be, you know, fluctuate too much over time like that. Okay. So, five, pick architecture. Using grid search, random search, or Bayesian optimization. So in the algorithm above, I said, pick an architecture of your choice. But how do you know, which architecture to pick, right? Maybe you want to search over it if you're a beginner. So a way to do it is let's suppose that you want to pick how many layers in the neural network, okay? Then you search over, you know, you search L number of layer from, you know, one layer, two layer, and then maybe L layer, okay? And then for each layer, you end up with, after you train, after you run training, maybe somewhere here, you have a final objective function, right? J, you have final J for L as well. Right, and then you pick the L that does best on your holdout set. Right, pick L that does best. On your holdout set. Okay. Now it could be it turns out that if you have one hyperparameter, so the number of layers, we call it hyperparameters. But if you have a lot of hyperparameters, then you end up with a lot of parameters to search out, hyperparameters to search over. Okay? So let's suppose that L could have, you know, 10 choices, and every layer have certain number of neurons to pick from, then you end up with, you know, 100 or 1,000 candidates to search over. Okay? Then the second idea is to do random search. Random search meaning that, you know, you pick randomly at some point in your hyperparameter space, and then try your training, get some objective function on the holdout set, and then do hill climbing nearby it. Okay? The third idea is to use Bayesian optimization, what Nando de Freitas presented yesterday. So what he did was he said that, okay, I remember this figure from his presentation. Let's suppose that, again, L is the one parameter, hyperparameter that you want to search over. And then maybe, this is 2, this is 5, maybe this is 10. Then you end up with some kind of objective function, right? And then you have a mean function over it. And then you also have a variance function. Okay. And then you want to decide where to pick the next architecture to try, how many layers to try. So yesterday he mentioned the idea of looking at the mean function, right? Mean function here, and add with the variance, right? So maybe here, pretty good. Next thing to try, maybe here is even better, right? Because it's higher. So, using some utility function, using the mean and the variance, you can pick the next best hyperparameter to try. Okay? So this is still a topic of current research in neural networks. So I wouldn't go and conclude which method is superior to the other methods. In particular, I don't have a lot of experience with this. But people have reported very good results using Bayesian optimization in the last few years, perhaps even better than human tweak architectures. Okay. To also pick good hyperparameters, you also should look at under fitting, and overfitting. Right. So if J on the holdout set is much worse than J on the train. This is larger because that's what you want to minimize. Training set. If your objective function is much better in the training set than the holdout set, that means you overfit, right? Then you should decrease the number of layer. Or decrease the number of neuron in each layer. Okay. If J on the training set is bad, right? Let's say you want to classify a data set, but it always at random, right? The performance is there at random. Then you should increase the number of layer or neuron, or maybe change the learning rate. 6, 7 use matrix vector library. So you notice in the computation in backpropagation, there's a lot of matrix vector multiplication. So if you use matrix vector libraries, you have some speed up over your own implementation of matrix vector. So it's almost always recommended that you use some existing matrix vector libraries because they are more optimized. Okay, maybe 3 or 4 times faster than your own code. And then maybe number 8 is you can use mini-batch. Right. So mini-batch meaning in the algorithm above, at every iteration, I pick an example k at random. Now instead of picking an example k at random, you can pick a mini-batch, which is 10 examples at a time, and then compute the gradient over them, and then sum up the gradient over all the examples, and use it as the update. Okay. Sometimes it's faster than the standard stochastic gradient descent, and faster because you can use better matrix vector multiplication. And when you have a mini batch, sometimes bigger and a larger number of examples can mean, when you multiply larger matrices, it can just be almost for free. Right. Okay. So that's some advice that I have if you want to train neural networks. Any question at this point? Yes. Yeah.
Maybe what do we do in cases where we have to learn that the neural network run for a long time before realizing that maybe 4 or 5 years was.
Yes. Okay. So the question is, how do we know when we converge? And maybe you try Bayesian optimization, but you try it too early, right? Well, I think we have that problem in practice. We don't have a very good solution for that. But usually what we do is we look at how much the parameters or the function value changes during optimization. If it doesn't change so much, or the parameters or the weights and the biases don't change a lot, that means it almost converges. Using some, let's say theta t, right? Maybe theta t denote the parameter at time t, minus theta t plus 1, right? And look at the norm. And if they smaller than some small number, that means it doesn't change a lot, right? And if it doesn't change a lot, it means you converge. Now, that's still dangerous. Because in a neural network, sometimes the optimization landscape can look like something like this, right? So let's suppose that because neural networks are not convex. So let's suppose that this is your theta, okay? And this is your j, right? Then sometimes you can have some objective function that look like that, where somewhere you have like a plateau region, and then for y, then until you can get down further. It does exist in practice, but it's very rare. Most of the time, we see that when it reaches this plateau, it means it converges. Yeah, but be warned that there are certain situations you need to check this. Okay. A lot of people use Bayesian optimization and they reported no problem at all. And I think it's just because checking convergence is easy, and you also don't have this problem. Have a question? Yeah, please.
For your algorithm for your 5 for random search work, do you need some sense of Lipschitz continuity
That I don't know. I think a lot of this is basically experience in practice, but people haven't proved theorems about whether it's going to converge or not. Okay. I think if you change J, it will change the optimization a little bit. But there are certain hyperparameters. For example, the number of neurons in the neural network, right? If you change from 100 to 105, right, the objective function wouldn't change too much. But the number of layers could be different. In practice, at Google, for example, we use networks of 10 layers or 11 layers and so on, and we observe that if you change from 10 layers to 11 layers or 12 layers, or maybe make it 9 layers, right? The function values kind of smooth. Yeah. I have a question. Question in the back, please.
So in modern data storage systems, as Alex pointed out yesterday, we favor sequential data processing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And how does that play with the fact that we have to pick random examples and labels at random?
I see. It's a couple of ideas that can work, but I don't think they are perfect yet. First idea, you can shuffle the data set ahead of time, right?
Yeah, that works for the first iteration. But like after we do the first pass over the data, do we have to reshuffle it again?
Maybe. The second idea is that we do prefetching. So let's say you have a computer that has 16 cores. You can use 8 cores to do matrix vector multiplication, and then 8 cores to read data into memory, right? And then that will save you the random lookup. It's not perfect, I agree. And in particular, stochastic gradient descent, if you do it in random order, it tends to work a little bit better than perfectly sequential. So it's sort of undesirable, but let's say if you don't like the fact that it's random, if you truly use sequential, it wouldn't be too bad, right? You lose a little bit, but it wouldn't be too bad. Okay. Please. Ran n. Yeah, please. Uh-huh. Oh, so if you initialize all the parameters at zeros, then most of your neurons are going to end up at zeros, right? If you initialize your vector to be zeros, right, then most of your neuron will be here, right? Because unless you change the bias to be 0.5, then most of your neuron going to be end here, right? But then you avoid, you violate this rule, break symmetry. Then most of the neurons will be doing the same thing, right? So stochastic gradient descent would have a hard time find the true parameter set for you. Any question? Okay, well understood.
Okay.
Why neural nets? And maybe why not? Okay, perhaps why not? Okay. So it's been observed that in the recent trend of using neural networks, neural networks turn out to be very good for natural data, for example, images, for audio, and also text. Okay, and the question is why? So it turns out that in natural data, you have a lot of non-linearity. So here's, for example, let's pick image classification as an example to see what do I mean by non-linearity. Okay, so first, let's say I have a digit 0, something like that, right? This is what we see. But what computers see is a 2D array where you have a lot of zeros, right? And then maybe 100, 180, 250, right? So what computer sees is a bunch of zeros, and then in the place that where you have the digit, you end up with some values that are very high. Okay, so this is what you see, but this is what the computer sees. So make sure that you understand that, right? And a conventional way to actually do, you know, a simple way to do object classification is to map this into a vector, right? So the algorithm before tell us that we need a vector. This is a matrix. Huh? So one way to map it is convert it into a 1D vector. So a 1D vector is to map it to here, right? Second dimension is here, third dimension is here, and et cetera, right? And then it wraps around, right? So this will go to first, and then second will go to here, and et cetera, right? And somewhere here, this will go to 200 here, okay? Okay, so this is the representation that you can do simple digit classification, okay? Now, what turns out that for image classification, you have the following problem. So let's suppose that you have a digit error like that. And then, let's say the digit gets shifted, right? Because when you take a camera, your hand might shake. You move it left, right? And then that's a zero, okay? So for you, this is the same digit, right? Zero. But let's say if I try that, then you end up with this number, that, right? Thus, for you, That's number 6. Okay. So what you do is, let's say, let's call this image number 1. Let's call this image number 2. And this call this image number 3. Okay. Then what you could compute the distance between these 3 digits, right? Using this representation here. So you could compute the Euclidean distance between I1 and I2, right? And then I1 and I3. Turns out that I ran some simulation, and maybe I end up this 10 to the 7. This is 10 to the 6. Okay? And the reason is that because these 2 digits, it overlaps almost the same except for this part, right? So what this demonstrated is that I1 is closer to I3 in Euclidean distance than I2. So what it's saying is I1 is closer to I3 than I1 to I2. Okay? So if you do a 1D visualization, then you might, let's have a 1D visualization, then I1 is there, and then I3 is there, right? And then I2 is there. Okay? You know? This is high-dimensional space projected in 1D. Okay? So what you know is that the decision function is the same for I1 and I2. So the decision function, your decision function, is the same for I1 and I2, but it's very different for I3. You know, the decision function is different. So it might look something like that, right? So if you use a linear decision function, you never achieve this property. So you have to actually use a very nonlinear function to accomplish the classification task where H will say I1 and I2 is the same, but I3 is not, right? Does this whole picture make sense? So the observation is, the conclusion of this observation is basically good. The conclusion is natural data have non-linear decision. So neural networks are very good for this task. Now, when it comes to nonlinear decision functions, there are 2 ways to do it, right? Way number 1 is to have a shallow neural network. So let's draw a neural network. Shallow means that you have a lot of neurons in one layer, okay? And then lots of connection. and then the number of neurons could be huge, right? And then try to come up with a decision function based on that. Or you end up with a deeper neural network that looks more like that. So this is number two, which is deep net. So let's say H is a very nonlinear function that we want to approximate. So there are two ways to do it, right? Number one is to have a shallow neural network. Number two is to have a much deeper neural network, right? So in theory, that could be, you know, quite equivalent. But in practice, which one is preferred? So it turns out that for this task over there, right, or on some audio classification task that we perform simulation at Google, let's say this input D could be like 1,000 dimension, right? In a simulation for the task of voice recognition on your phone, by the way. So this is what you actually use on your phone, okay? So you could train 12 layer nets, right? Of 1,000 layer each, 1,000 neuron each on each of this layer, to achieve an error rate of maybe 10%. This is a data set that we have, okay? This is the best that we could get with a 12 layer neural network. So the question is, if you have to do it with a shallow neural network, how many neurons in here that we have to use, right? That's an intriguing question. Right. The question, and it turns out that in order to do something like this, with one layer, you have one layer. You actually have to end up using 400,000 neurons, and you don't even get 10%. You get 11% or so. So, in order to get like 10%, you actually get to like a million. Right. So in terms of practical application, a shallow net, the memory footprint is much higher and could be much slower to evaluate. You can actually work out how many flops you actually need to compute using a shallow net compared to deep net. And it turns out in many practical applications, deep net is more effective. Yeah, I have a question over there. You mean this one? You mean why in theory? This? Oh, okay. There's a theory for that. I could summarize the theory a little bit, but I think you could look up for research in this area. So the claim is that let's suppose that you have a very complicated logic function in here. So maybe, let's say here are binary units, okay? Like a Boolean unit. The input are Boolean units. And the output is some complicated Boolean function, right? So let's suppose, you know, x1 and x2, right? Or x3, you know, and x5. For etc. Right, it's a very complicated function. To actually represent the neural network, if you know the Boolean function, you can actually lay it out into an architecture, and it's very efficient. Now, if you don't know that, right? If you don't know that, and then you want to use one layer to do it, and then you actually have to remember for all the cases, and that could be exponential. Okay. People prove theorems like this, and if you want to chat about it, we can talk about it offline. But the I think the paper is, if you can look it up, this paper, Joshua Benjo, and then Jan Lekun. The title of the paper is Deep Architecture. For AI. Okay. So there's a paper that proposed that theorem. Any question at this point in time? Yes. Then you can, then in practice, you can overfit significantly. Right? You can, it's a trade-off between a function expressiveness and overfitting, right? So, that's the point. And also, if you use more layers, it could be more expensive to evaluate, right? And maybe you don't need it in practice. And again, it's too small to use it. Any questions? I clean the board, and if you have any questions, just ask me. Questions? Okay. So one more thing that I want to comment before going to deep learning is rectify linear units. So remember that the activation function that we used yesterday is a sigmoid function, or a function that looks like this. This is 0.5. This is 1. This is 0. Okay. This is x. This is g of x. Okay. So this function is sometimes called a logistic function. Or sometimes called sigmoid function. Okay, so it's been very popular in neural networks for many, many years until around, 2007. Okay, but recently a lot of best neural networks that we use don't have this function anymore. And they have a different activation function that look like this. So this is x again, right? This is g of x again. So the value of function is 0 and then x, okay? So So g of x is max 0 and x, right? So this function is also called rectified linear unit. Okay? And it looks like that shape instead of that shape. Okay? So the question is why this works better than that, right? So the answer is this. So I can provide some intuition, right? But this is not a definite, not a definite answer. So I think it's still a topic of current research. But here's some observation. Okay. So let's look at this function and look at the derivative of this function. Okay. The derivative of that function should look like this. When the function, this is 0, right? So the derivative is almost 0 here and almost 0 here, except for here, which is almost 1. So the derivative of that function is like that, okay? This is the derivative of g over x. Okay? The derivative of this function would look different. Look something like. It would be 0 and then 1. Right? Here, this is non-differentiable, but let me cheat by just saying that, you know, some arbitrary value that maybe 1. Okay. So the derivative of this function look like that, where the derivative of this function look like that. So why the derivative matters? So it turns out that in the backpropagation algorithm, what you actually multiply with the error coming from above is the derivative, right? The g prime in what I wrote yesterday. And the property of this derivative is that is the value is very small on both ends, right? So you end up with the derivative, when you do backpropagation, what you end up is, let's say you have a neural network that looks like this. So this, let's say the derivative here is the derivative of j theta 2, namely the parameter is in this layer. And then if you look at the magnitude of the derivative, this is for the first layer. Then you see that the derivative of the top layer is much bigger than the partial derivative in the second in the lower layer. Okay, but if you use this function right here, right, that property doesn't appear anymore. Namely, the derivative looks balanced over the coordinate. Now, why I talk about balance over the coordinate, right? So it turns out that in optimization, if your derivative is imbalanced over the coordinate, what you end up seeing is the objective function is very skewed, right? So let's say that's minimum, right? And let's say the derivative of this direction is much larger than the derivative of this direction, right? Then you have to pick a very, very small learning rate to actually descend. It takes a long time to converge. Whereas if you have very good derivative, then you end up with this small center that looks like that. Then you can pick a large learning rate to descend to the minimum. Okay. And the best networks that people use so far, I think many of them use this activation function, and this gives you an intuition of what's going on. And by the way, what I draw in here is the contour of J, and this is two coordinates, theta 1, theta 2, this is the contour, theta 1, theta 2, this is the contour, okay? And this in optimization, people call it like a valley, right? When you are in a valley, you need to pick a very small learning rate, otherwise you overshoot. Is everything, is something unclear? Yes?
Doesn't that also depend on the nature of the data? If you have some features taking really large values,
sure. That also depends on the input data. First of all, in general, you should normalize your data. Okay. So in general, when you have data coming in, you should normalize your data, right? You subtract the mean divided by the variance or something like that to before training, okay? Now, let's say you can't do that, right? It turns out that in natural data, you don't need to normalize, right? Because audio signal doesn't have values that, you know, go wide. And for images, you don't have values that are going very wide. So generally, you don't have problems like this for image classification or phone classification. Okay. Yes.
So this red timing unit.
Yeah. Yeah. That can be a problem. Yeah, but you can't achieve both, right? So the argument is that this can be very sensitive to outlier, right? But you can't achieve both. This basically counter for the outlier, but in the wrong way, because you end up with wrong gradient. Yeah, you have to make a trade-off at some point. I have a question. Oh, so this nonlinearity? So an alternative is maybe something like that, right? Something like that. I haven't seen something like that try before. So I could... you know, welcome you to try, and then, you know, maybe see how it performs. I'm surprised that people haven't tried it before. Yeah, but it could be a good idea. But one more thing, okay? So some people say that maybe here is non-differentiable, right? So maybe one approximation to this is maybe making something smoother, right? Maybe something like that, right? And hope for the best. Maybe it works better because you can take the derivative here. It turns out it performs worse in a lot of experience, in a lot of experiments that we have. And I think the fact that it has some values exactly zeros prevents, you know, a lot of noisy values in here, right? So that we also saw too. Yeah. I see. So when the gradient is exactly zero, you don't update anything, right? But there are certain examples that that particular neuron is not saturated. So it would be bad if a neuron would be saturated all the time or most of the time. But it would be okay if it's saturated sometimes.
With the rectified linear
unit, yeah. For certain example, it's not exactly zero. It could be here. So again, that's a good point. So a good initialization for rectified linear unit is to make sure that the neuron spend most of their time here, right? And then after you train, maybe it will push the values to here, right? And another good visualization technique is to look inside the neuron and see how many of them actually zeros at a certain point, at a certain example, right? And it turns out that for neural networks that train with rectified linear and linear units, a good fraction of neurons can be zeros. Maybe 80% of the neurons be zeros at for a given example. But the state of the network change for different examples. Yeah. So this encourages sparsity as well. Any question? Yeah. I erase the board, and if you have questions, just ask. No questions so far? Okay. So far I've talked about neural networks. Okay. But the topic of today and yesterday was deep learning. So why neural networks, right? Where do things fit in? So it turns out that deep learning is in general a set of algorithms that makes use of neural networks as an architecture is a set of algorithms. One definition is a set of algorithms that use an architecture, and one of such algorithms is supervised learning. Example is supervised learning. With stochastic gradient descent. Right? What we saw before. There are many other algorithms which I'm gonna present next in the next hour or so. So this is one definition, okay? But many people have other, many of my friends have different definitions of what called deep learning. So it's not totally agree in the community yet. So another algorithm, another definition is also a set of algorithm, same. But the number of layers has to be larger than 2. Okay? So what people call deep, meaning that the neural networks have to be deep. Okay? So in here I say it's a neural network. Neural network could be 1 layer, could be 2 layers, and it could be 3 layers or 12 layers. But for some of my friends say that in order to qualify to be called deep, the number of layers have to be larger than 2. And the current revolution in deep learning turns out the fact that a lot of really good networks are really, really deep, right? 12 layers, 15 layers, and also. So there's a point in saying this, okay? And a lot of other of my friends, for them, the definition is the same, but they say that it can make use of unlabeled data. So it turns out that neural nets can be tricky to train, right? They can be very slow if you initialize strongly, or it can overfit if your problem is small. And then in the 1990s, people begin to give up on neural networks, okay? And in around 2006, and in 2006, a famous figure in deep learning is Jeff Hinton. What he discovered was the fact that if you pre-train your neural networks using some unlabeled data, and you pre-train the neural network using an algorithm called restricted Boltzmann machine, I call it RBM. Right? He trained a neural network called RBMs. What the neural network basically does is trying to reconstruct the input. Okay, so he have a deep neural network trying to reconstruct the input, and then use it as an initialization for your network, your supervised train network. So instead of initialized randomly, he initialized a network that been trained using unlabeled data. And then he observed that there's a huge improvement in accuracy. And then since then, people associated deep learning with the fact that you could use unlabeled data. Okay, but things begin to change recently. Is that the fact that when we come to Google, at Google we have lots and lots of data and lots of computational power. So overfitting is not an issue for us, and neither long convergence. Right? It might take several months to train, but now because you can use a lot of computers, the training would take maybe a couple of weeks. Right? So it's much faster. And then we don't observe, the benefit of using unlabeled data decreases, right? But the name sticks. So a lot of people still believe that in order to qualify to be called deep learning, you should make use of unlabeled data. Okay? So the RBM's algorithm I'm going to discuss in 15 minutes or so. But be aware of the fact that the definition of deep learning can be inconsistent among many people in the field. Okay. With that, I also want to mention a little bit of history of neural networks and then deep learning. So in around 1950s, right, that's a long, long time ago. So we have an algorithm called perceptron. So the perceptron, the guy who discussed this algorithm is Rosen Blatt. He came up with a way to train a classifier that can classify your data, which is what you saw in the first lecture, right? In the very first part of the lecture where I presented a linear classifier. It's not exactly the same, but the spirit is the same. And people were very excited about that. You know, machines can learn. That's awesome. But it turns out that in around 1970s, people discovered that perceptron, a linear classifier, cannot classify, nonlinear data. For example, this data set. Right? So you can't draw any linear margin to classify this example. It doesn't work, right? Any linear decision function wouldn't work for this data set. Right? So people gave up on neural networks. And then around I think in the around 1980s or maybe 1990s, people realized that if you could, instead of using one linear classifier, you use multiple layer neural networks, you can classify this data set, right? So people discover hierarchical. And call it neural network, okay? And then neural network can classify this data set, which I presented in the earlier lecture, okay? And then late 1990s, neural network overfit a lot. And then people realize that if you use, in theory, if you use a one-layer neural network, it works just fine. And in the form of something called kernel method, which, you know, Alex Smoller is, you know, world-class expert in here. Right? So people move on to do something called kernel method. It turns out that kernel method is a one-layer neural network with infinite number of nodes in the first layer here. But they have something called the kernel trick. So the kernel trick is basically you take X, okay, and then you map it in phi X. Right? But you never compute phi X explicitly. What you do is every time during your training, you need, it turns out that most algorithms need X times X prime. So in your algorithm, you replace your X and X prime, some other example, by phi of x and phi of x prime. And this dot product, even though phi of x is infinite, the dot product is done very cheaply, right? And that's a huge breakthrough. And then this is such an attractive property. And then people stop using neural nets and move on to use kernel methods a lot. Right, and neural networks doesn't work very well because, you know, it's slow to train, it overfits a lot, it's non-convex. This has a property that is convex as well, which is better. So because of many properties, people gave up on neural nets. Right, and then do we still have space? Around 2006, in parallel, Toronto University, Montreal, I think, and maybe Stanford, I don't know, and some other lab, maybe even NYU. In parallel, I think they discover that if you use unlabeled data, to initialize the training of neural network, right? You use unlabeled data, you train a neural network to approximate input-output, and then use that to initialize your neural network, it works much better. And then the second idea is around 2009, people discover that GPUs is a great idea for neural network. So GPUs is basically graphical graphics, graphic cards, right? Like NVIDIA graphic card. It makes the training maybe 10, 20, or maybe 100 times faster than before. And then suddenly everything becomes much easy to train, right? The problem with neural network is if you are a beginner, you pick an architecture, you train it, maybe it takes several weeks, but then it doesn't work. It doesn't work maybe because you're training badly, or maybe your architecture is bad, etc. Right? You don't know. But after waiting for like a month, it doesn't work, then you feel like, you know, you're doing no work. But if with GPUs, if you train it for 100 times faster, then your job will take a couple of hours. Then after a couple of hours, you realize that your neural net doesn't work very well, then you change the architecture, you change the better learning rate, and etc. And things suddenly work better, right? So the fast iteration in doing experiments is much better using GPUs. And then things become much better since. And then I would say around 2011, we use neural networks for acoustic modeling, so to classify phoneme. So basically, when you talk to the phone, you have some windows of your speech. You want to classify what phoneme that is. That's, you know, etc. It's not a word. It's a little part in your word. Okay, and that is essentially for speech recognition to work. Right? It's very essential to get your speech recognition on your phone to work. Previously, people used some shallow architecture to classify it. And then when they use neural network, the improvement was so significant that when you talk to some people who did speech recognition, they said that if you look at the improvements in the last 20 years in speech recognition and you sum them up, right, and then you compare to the gain using neural networks, then they're almost comparable, right? And even better, so neural nets can even be even better. And that's, that generates so much excitement in the field. So right, and then around, and by the way, this network is trained without a label, without unlabeled data, so it's fully trained by supervised. Right, the algorithm that I presented, what you saw before, right, it's a 12-layer neural network. Rectify linear unit, fully supervised, maybe 2,000 units on each layer. The input is like 700 dimension, and that's it, right? Nothing fancy at all. So around 2012, right? So at Google, the Google Brain project. By the way, the Google Brain project started almost the same time with the result in speech recognition. And with the Google Brain also obtained the breakthrough as well. But the Google Brain, and there's a New York Times article on how many computers you can recognize a cat, okay? And it's such a useless result, many people could say. But it shows that fundamentally, neural networks can actually discover features that it takes a long time for human expert to engineer. Okay, and then because of that result, around that time, neural network also won several image classification competition. Okay, and the most famous one is ImageNet. It's called ImageNet. So, well, it's hard to describe the improvement, but let me try that. So, of all candidates using human engineer features in computer vision, they all achieve almost the same performance, right? But this, the neural network, the train fully supervised, it requires some human tweaking in the architecture and so on. achieve 20% better than the second best candidate. And that's such a huge breakthrough. And now if you go to computer vision like CVPR or ICCP, most of the papers there will be on neural networks, and a special type of neural networks called convolution neural networks. And if you also, if you work on speech recognition and if you do acoustic modeling, if you go to conferences like InterSpeech or maybe ICASP, most of them also use neural networks as well. So these two results, like these two sets of results make a huge breakthrough. The results is what you use today, right? The speech recognition on the phone is basically a neural network. And if you upload pictures onto Picasa or Google Plus or Facebook or Figma, most likely you interact with a neural network too. And the results are basically remarkable. Right. So, okay. I would attribute the success in using GPUs, right, and using rectified linear units. Right. Yeah. Right. And the success in using large computational cluster, what we use in Google Brain. So computation turns out to be key in the success of deep learning in the current wave, and also the use of smart choice of learning, right? Smart choice of the activation function. Any question at this point? Okay. So tomorrow I will talk about Google Brain, okay? Because Google Brain is a little bit complicated, maybe I should start with some of the most useful architectures for neural nets, right? They're suitable for particular applications. So the first architecture is called autoencoder. So the autoencoder is an unsupervised neural network, okay? And the idea is as follows. You take in input data, x. You construct some neurons. And then you're trying to reconstruct . So the autoencoder is very simple. This is a one-layer autoencoder where you're trying to learn the parameters in such a way that your mapping is similar to the input. Okay? And then you can use stochastic gradient descent again to minimize the objective. Right? Is everything clear? Yes? Yeah, that's a constraint. So before, in the algorithm before, the output is only one, okay? But in this algorithm, the output has to be a vector, right? And it turns out that you can actually apply the same principle in computing the derivative using backpropagation like before, right? And yeah. Now, a deeper autoencoder is something like a deeper autoencoder, you can have some other number of hidden layers. And then the only constraint is the number of output. It's the same with the number of input, right? The number of nodes. And then the goal is to try to reconstruct the input. Okay? That's the deep autoencoder. This is an autoencoder, and that's the deep autoencoder. And then you could maybe, you know, increase the number of layers you wish, right? So again, I want to go back to the idea that Jeff Hinton had, right? And Joshua Banjo and many other had. The idea was that basically neural networks was difficult to train, and the claim was that if you train this way, okay, or you train that way, and then after you're done training, you remove the last layer, and then you tack on the label, and then you continue the training using label data, right? And then that way you can actually initialize your supervised network with a network that been trained using unlabeled data before, right? And the other idea is actually train greedily one layer at a time. So let's suppose that you have a deep network to do classification. Okay, it could have 10 layers. Then you try to learn one layer autoencoder at a time, right? And then after you train, you done training, you do feed forward so that you have the features, and then train another autoencoder, and then keep going until you train 12 autoencoders, right? And then in the last stage, you plug tack on the label, and then use it to train your supervision. And that's called unsupervised learning, unsupervised feature learning. Okay? Yeah, question. Yeah. I see. Okay. Yeah. I give a bit of intuition, right? It's still not well understood. It is actually true in practice, right? If you have a small data set, if you train using unlabeled data and then initialize that to train with labeled data, it works better. You see that in practice and all over again, especially when the data set is small. So people came up with a different intuition. My intuition is the following. So let's suppose that you want to classify images of cars, right? And let's suppose that your data has some idiosyncrasies in such a way that the middle pixel is always black, okay? So the network will learn and erase all the whites in the network in such a way that as long as there's one connection to the middle pixel and saying that middle pixel is black, then that's a car. Right, so it learns some idiosyncrasies of the input data, right? And that's undesirable, right? And the idea of unsupervised learning is to try to reconstruct the input. And if you just learn idiosyncrasies in the data, you can't reconstruct the input anymore, right? So you have to do some. You have to learn meaningful representation of the input to reconstruct the data, and that's the intuition why it works well. Yeah, that's one argument of that. Yeah. Yes.
The autoencoder, is there any requirement for number of neurons in the middle layer versus the input layer of the layer?
Yeah. So usually an autoencoder is more popular than a deep autoencoder. So what people do is they train an autoencoder. So let's go back to the idea of pre-training, where you train with unlabeled data. And then, so the idea of pre-training is follow. So let's suppose that you have a deep neural network like this. to train some supervision, right? So the first stage is that you pick out this architecture right here, and then you tack on another layer, and then train autoencoder. And then you keep this as a feature, and then use it as that feature, and then block this thing out as another autoencoder. And then, after you're done, you block this out as another autoencoder. And then once you've done that, you use that as an initialization to train this layer. Oh, these are two, right? You don't have any constraint in the number. Right top. Oh, okay. Maybe that I didn't explain that very well yet. So I wanna go over that there. Okay. So the neural network look like maybe 4, 3, 3, and then it will be 1. Okay. So the sequence of steps that I'm gonna train is the following. I'm gonna take this, and then I'm gonna construct an autoencoder that looks like this. Okay, and the parameter here is W1, and this is W1 prime. Okay, I'm gonna train autoencoder, and this is X prime. I'm gonna try to approximate X with X prime. Okay, so that's the first step. And then after I'm done, I take W1 and plug it in here. And then I get the output, which is 3 features. Okay, and then I'm gonna block this out. This is the next step. So this is H1 of X. Okay. So this is gonna be H1 of X. And this is H1 of X prime. And this is W2 prime. Okay. So I'm gonna train another autoencoder where I take W2 as input here, and then I try to train W2 prime here. And then H1 of X is constructed by taking the input data, multiply by W1, and apply some nonlinearity, and then drive that. And I'm going to train an autoencoder to approximate H1. Does that make sense? And then you keep going until you get, you've done, I think. And then you train that layer, and that's good. You have to move forward. You take your X, you multiply so that you have the result, right? H1 is the data being is the output that when you get X as input. So you use the same set of unlabeled examples. So my data test set is basically the same, right? And then in the first step, I'm gonna train an autoencoder to learn W using my data X. After I'm done training, I'm gonna take X and multiply with my W1 and get some representation, okay? And use it as my new data, okay? Question? Usually people say you want a compressed representation where the number of neurons is smaller than the input, but it doesn't have to be. People say that there's certain nonlinearity in the data that you can capture using a deep neural network rather than a shallow neural network. So let's suppose that, if you go back to the autoencoder here, right, this is basically compression, right, data compression using either some kind of nonlinear function or linear or less linear function, right? There might be that your data has some nonlinear properties in it that you can compress using a deeper network rather than shallow network. People observe that for images, that's indeed the case. But the purpose of an autoencoder as a pre-training step is not about just about compression, but it's just about learning some representation that could be good as an initialization for a deep neural network. Yeah. Yeah.
When you train your backpropagation, do you use backpropagation to modify the parameters that you learned?
Yeah, that's a great question. So first, you train this layer only, okay, using backpropagation. And then after you've done that, you train everything. Because at the beginning, this is going to be random, right? So you don't want this randomness here modifying everything. Right, but after you train this, you could allow to train all the steps. Okay. Yeah. Question. Okay. So it turns out that when you have a network that is really deep, it's difficult to train. So people tend to break it into steps. And that's easier. Result-wise, people saw that if you train stepwise and then use it as initialization for this, then the result is better. More accurate. I still have a few things to present, but maybe I can stop there and then we can keep going tomorrow. But you know, I welcome questions now, and if you have anything, just you know, I would be after the lecture and can talk.